What's that piece? I mean, I've just started filming this piece, but I don't know if you want me to.
No, it's fine. I mean, it's up because I am attracted to it. It's a collage piece that I was doing, I think, before COVID. I had a whole series that was supposed to be in that little show at the Beacon Artists Union, Everything 2020, which is basically a like 20 or so pieces, but not 20 works on the show, that kind of went along the lines of this explosion piece, using fragments of collage as paint, really, just as paint, using fragments of collage to represent line. And I had this like chaos in mind actually before the pandemic, because it turned out to be so much more shitty than 2020 was turning out to be in March, but this is probably made in February. It's like tons of magazines and color aid paper cut apart, and the black background is actually mostly graphite. It's graphite and polymer mixed. Be like, what's this stuff?
Well, what is it?
I was, do you want me to talk about
this? Yes, tell me. What's in here?
I don't know. This is a weird thing that I was going through at some point. It was last fall, where I started to make these still lives in the yard. And this is a still life that I created out of some stovepipe and a sheet that we got at a tag sale. And I wanted to paint it. I wanted to paint this thing, and I wanted to go and experiment with atmospheric washes and glazes and layering the paint and leaving these like kind of ghosty, I'm saying atmospheric again, but these like deep spaces around the garden.
Well, it's cool because this, I've never seen this. And it's a little different from some of the stuff that I've seen of yours, but a lot of your work, or like the work of yours that I think of as emblematic of your kind of style, as I think of it, is like, well, certainly like depth, different layers, and kind of smashed, though, like smashed into sort of flattened, but also these materials, like you are, to me, you're like a materials person. In fact, in all the time I've spent with you, I've heard you talk about tag sales. You talk about tag sales so frequently. But my point is, what's interesting about this piece, hold on, I want to look, can we look at that one a little more? What's interesting to me about this is that it's like your yard, stuff you got at a tag sale, and kind of piled in your yard, which is all very common stuff. But it looks to me like a very wide open landscape, and there's something very monumental about it. Like the scale seems, I associate this with almost like it looks like a mesa or something, and there's miles and miles and miles of desert or open space behind it. And I think it's interesting because a lot of the stuff that I've seen of yours, it does one or the other. It either it reverses like kind of open spaces into, it collapses open spaces into sort of more flattened kind of zones, or this one is doing the opposite for me. I'm curious about like, the sort of spatial thing. I mean, you said, you sort of described this simply as like a still life, but there's like a lot of interesting sort of spatial stuff going on.
This, well, I guess I have this attraction to the structure. And this work kind of communicated with the work I did 10 years ago when I was really getting into painting in Brooklyn in my master's program. I would usually create like these kind of empty atmospheric spaces around some sort of structure. And this kind of went back to that, but in a way where I was, instead of using collaged architecture, I created some architecture in my yard with whatever I had, so I could try to achieve that same feeling of like there's cavernous space inside, and there's the sheet that kind of wraps around something, and you're not really sure what it is, but you can assume it's something like this, but you can never really look underneath the sheet, and it creates some tension. And the lines kind of draw you right to that point.
Yeah.
But yeah, everything that I was doing when I was painting last year was kind of a derivative, moving away from structures, but maybe exploring structures in different ways. Like this piece was around the same time period where I was doing fabric and tarps and like still that same like trailer park, grandpa, makeshift, like a farmer engineer. Like you just take what you have and you make it into something interesting with what you have. And what you have is basically not too much, right? So that's like a green tarp that I'd use in an interior construction, which was something I was also going through during my exploration of the last 2 years, trying to rediscover myself and finding meaning in what I'm doing. And this was like the precursor.
Right. So this is when I was kind of trying to say something about this sort of collapsing of spaces. This is the piece, or pieces like this are kind of what I was thinking of. So yeah, tell us about that one.
Oh geez, yeah. So between probably 2013 and 2017, I suppose, when we had Juniper, I was working on the house every day. And I kind of put art aside because I needed to provide for my family and create a home out of something that was the shell of a home, kind of like a pizza parlor in upstate New York. So, with the wood paneling, which comes across in a lot of my pieces as well. It's like a little bit like my personal struggle. But this has got fragments of beacon, like the fort down at Long Dock Park that someone built out of driftwood. This house is actually blue. It's down the street. It's got a really nice big backyard and was flipped. A lot of the houses were flipped that I kept digging through their dumpsters and taking pictures of the progress. And the ladder and the window is Juniper's room. Now it's Marcella's room. But that stuff doesn't matter, I suppose. It's more about like, this is my day-to-day, and I'm making compositions with my day-to-day struggles and thoughts. And my day-to-day is that of a regular human in America these days.
Well, right, and struggling a little bit. What I like about this piece, and what I sort of have thought about it in similar stuff over the past year or two as I've gotten to know your work, is like, yeah, it's like very much looks like our neighborhood. We live in the same neighborhood. Very much looks like our neighborhood, but what you've done with it is like, again, I keep saying collapsed. I mean, I don't know that that's necessarily the right word, but there's a sort of rearranging in this way that gives it's sort of like your one's impression. You're sort of like expressing your impression of the neighborhood as you go through, you know, as you kind of go through your life or whatever. It's not a literal representation, certainly, but the way that you kind of restructure everything is, I don't know, I'm kind of drawn to it.
Well, thank you, Mark.
Yeah, I mean, I love it.
I think some of it, I guess, has to go if we want to get into like where it comes from. It probably comes from my something about my understanding and the way I assemble space and other things, the way I build things, is pretty much from the perspective of someone who was like struggling in school. I'm pretty sure that a lot of that, like trying to understand something in your own way without being able to follow the directions, like putting together IKEA furniture without the instruction manual.
Right.
There are things that you can appropriate for other things, And in the end, you realize that you screwed something up because it's clearly not looking like it's supposed to in the catalog. But
so the painting like the one we were just looking at is like our neighborhood kind of put back together without the instructions or something.
Yeah. The how I used to talk about it last year, or however many years ago, a year and a half ago, is that I was a little bit fascinated with the way people would fix things and the way people would in our houses. Like, you have a house in the neighborhood, we bought this house, and the way that the common person would fix their own wiring
mm-hmm.
or not insulate things
mm-hmm.
became hilarious to me
mm-hmm.
in like the darkest, most horrible way. just like what is going on? But then
yeah, the sort
I
of the tinkering, yeah, definitely. A lot of these homes in this area are like really super tinkered with.
Oh my god!
But it drives you crazy, or it amuses you.
People that are watching this
right.
would be like, "Oh, Beacon, yeah."
Oh, it's true though. There's such a different. There's a different. Yeah, there are different impressions of places, of course, and you only really get to know it once you know how.
And then in the city, when we were in Brooklyn, there was this beautiful 1880s, 1890s architecture, and everything was just like beautiful as it was, as you know, in disrepair and
totally.
Falling apart. Just it was beautiful, like Newburgh.
Uh-huh.
And Newburgh is beautiful.
Right.
There's no doubt about it.
Right.
But you might drive through Newburgh and see all sorts of crazy stuff
right.
on the streets.
Right.
Actually,
right.
All that I always think of is the dead black cat that we saw as a family walking up the hill. Oh, don't look. don't look. But this sort of weirdness that was just all experimentation was a precursor to the piece we just looked at. And this was just an awnings fixation because I removed a lot from our...
Oh, the awnings one. Oh, yeah, I love the awnings stuff.
And there's a bunch of them. It was kind of like going back into painting from observation, but painting from observation in a Photoshop, right?
Yeah, right, right.
Where I would go in and edit in Photoshop. I would edit some photos I took around the neighborhood. These are just studies.
So wait, so you would edit photos... You would sort of collage things in Photoshop?
Yeah, like this one is just straight up just a photograph that I took pieces of the house and just decided to paint them. It's very much a study. It's just like, I really just love this.
But where
this
does the... I think you should talk about the process a little bit. So you took photograph of the house.
Yeah.
And then you've sort of... I mean, you painted from that photograph.
From observation,
uh-huh.
yeah.
Okay.
Usually because I'm not working, like, on... I'm not, like, driving around
sure,
with an easel.
Of course. So, but then how does Photoshop come into play? Because you mentioned Photoshop.
Oh, Photoshop.
Right.
I don't have Photoshop, but I have access to Photoshop.
Uh-huh.
In which I do this, like, weird cutting apart.
Uh-huh.
It's just a virtual collage, so
yeah.
It's more expensive for me to print out all my photos that I take casually around the neighborhood, like,
right.
You know, stuff that's not really worth saving. I used to do it and go to like Office Max or something with a flash drive and plug it in and just like print a billion color map photos and treat them with a UV like coating so they wouldn't fade over time. And then in the last 2 years, I've decided to focus more on painting than collage, even though some of the work that you were looking earlier and everything at the beginning of 2020 was a lot of collage and experimental application of paint and other material. But I keep going back into painting and wanting to try to be more disciplined as an experiment with my work, going from photos that I've taken instead of cutting apart the photos. I'm like, you paint those photos, Matt. Like, get serious. This is art. So I'll sit down and I'll be like, I'm going to paint this whole Photoshop thing that I did.
Right.
And a lot of these like weird compilations, I won't go too far into it, but a lot of this stuff that I really enjoyed working on, but it was...
Ah, this is great.
It was painful, you know, to paint wood grain I have a tool for the flat stuff, but like to
here, let's
I'm painting a. Some of the reference photos that I found here were. I like looked up bad real estate photos.
Okay, I was gonna ask. Okay, so
and I was like, this is so inspiring. I need to make a painting about this mirrored room.
Yes, so this is great. The source material for this, or I guess rather the term would be like your reference, is real estate photos.
Oh, some of this series, besides stuff from our neighborhood, I started like pulling. I'm like, how do I represent what I saw in my home and what we removed and didn't document because we were too embarrassed?
Right.
Like, how do I represent that? There's a triangular structure floating in the room, but it's like basically when we tear down walls and stuff and we remove that wood paneling, this is what it looks like, the studs and the you know, the drawing board. Why it's floating in a room is like, I don't know, subconscious weirdness coming out of my brain.
Right. So I was going to ask, I mean, that
why is it floating?
Yeah. It's kind of difficult because, you know, the last thing you ever want to do really when talking about art is like say that it's like dreamlike or something, right? Because I know, I mean, this is so old hat. I mean, it's so cliched to do that, but it really does. I really do struggle to say, to put it in other terms, because I do feel like a lot of your pieces are like, yeah, it seems like it's like, the sort of experience of like dreaming a neighborhood. Like they're very, it's very much like tied to where you live. It's very much tied to the fact that, again, like I said, you're really a materials person. You know, you're the kind of person that is not like me at all. You look at a house and you kind of think of what went into the house, like what is behind the walls and what went into making it. Yeah. You look at an entire neighborhood and you're doing that constantly. Like you sort of process things in that way. But then the way that these paintings are structured is like, you know, again, they're not literal representations. It seems to me more like somebody who's having a fever dream of a neighborhood or of a house or of a real estate market.
Yeah.
I think it's like, you know, it feels like an entire real estate market kind of crammed together and dreamt about or something.
It's like an ADD person
reality. Or that, yeah, maybe.
So, I don't know. Just as a conclusion, to that, yeah. I think Photoshop really helped me paint while still getting those aspects of collage that I really appreciate.
Totally.
Taking imagery and kind of like you're saying, compressing them into almost like one, compressing them into a picture plane where they might not actually fit.
Right.
Like I'm really giving, really give too much information almost.
In the paintings themselves, you mean?
Yeah. I feel the need to express everything. Uh-huh. And that's something that usually, you know, people are like, whoa, tear it down, right? You're talking about a lot here, Matt. It's hard to comprehend. And it is harder to comprehend. But it's part of the journey.
Yeah.
You know, like the piece here and these pieces, it's all chaos in a way. It's like, it's a chaotic representation of the information that I am inputting into my brain on a daily basis. And it just comes out in absurdity. But the other conversation is like kind of getting into how I did the sports pieces recently and why, I guess.
Okay, so the sports paintings, meaning the ones that are in the show.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So what about them? Where did they come from?
Oh yeah. So actually, some of these pieces are in the show, but when I first started to draw and paint with, I was using like whatever I had just laying around. I wasn't like going and buying fresh acrylic paint. I had, you know, 10-year-old paint from Pratt garbage can when I was painting.
Right.
So I was using a lot of colored pencils and tempera and whatever I had around and on watercolor paper. And I was making these drawings and paintings that were kind of layered historical photos about public spaces and, like some of them are gymnasiums in Manhattan, with the old equipment in there, with the what are they called? The something horses.
Yeah.
I keep calling them sawhorses. What are they called? Like, it's not a sawhorse.
No. I forget what they're called.
But you know, the old gym equipment from the late 1800s.
Totally.
That you might still find in some gymnasiums. Where my brother coaches, he's assistant coach at WPI, and they have an old gym with the track ring, much like the YMCA in I think it's, God, what street was it? Is it? It's Upper Manhattan, 100 something street, but they have an old gymnasium as well. So some of it is layering these different spaces on each other to create more space. Like it's my attempt of creating like this endless space, or like this this piece that you're looking at is a couple of gymnasiums with all these banners that are kind of made up. It's almost like this one's almost like an illustration.
Mm-hmm.
And in the bleachers, there's just like piles of line and tangles of different material, kind of filling where people would be, I suppose. A weird thing is that I don't like sports at all, and I have nothing draws me to sports at all. But
well, so then what? So what? Why is the subject of all of these paintings?
Well, not all of it comes from the fact that my family was really into basketball, and I could never understand why.
Uh-huh.
But it kind of came from this love of history and looking at public spaces when I lived in New York City, looking at these larger public spaces, looking through the historic photographs and seeing these big empty spaces. Also, my fascination with empty spaces, currently abandoned places.
Yeah.
My work 10 years ago was, you know, sometimes labeled as post-apocalyptic, which is embarrassing. It's just an embarrassing thing. Like, it feels like...
Why?
Super... It's like if someone called you emo.
Yes.
Day, you're like, okay.
Well, or dreamlike. or dreamlike, which I just did a minute ago. But I mean, you know, I guess... I don't know. At some point, these things just are... You know, they have a certain... There's a certain way that people can use these terms to relate to your work. But tell me why it's not post-apocalyptic.
Well, this particular thing...
For example, sure.
Well, I suppose you could say that everyone is dead because there's some sort of apocalypse, but it's really just empty spaces.
Yeah,
empty spaces are so beautiful because you get to actually see the architecture.
Sure.
It's not about the people. It's not necessarily about the people interacting with the space. It's the space and like any evidence of people or happenings. It's kind of like, you know, if you're swinging into a cave as Indiana Jones and you're in the Temple of Doom and everyone's face is melting, but or is that not Temple of Doom? but I think it is. You're getting to create your own story when you go into an empty space, you can find evidence, you know, of happenings, and your brain takes you all sorts of places when you see these empty spaces with like evidence of someone being there, like an empty McDonald's bag, and you're like, I wonder who's the man.
Sure. I mean, I dig this. I think it's a really interesting conversation. Could be like a, you know, another thing entirely to sort of jump off from. But it's interesting. Like you know, doing these representations of public spaces, either abandoned or just unoccupied, not necessarily abandoned.
Yeah.
Disused or whatever, like, yeah, that the common sort of term that we, you know, or whatever thing default is post-apocalyptic or apocalyptic. Mm-hmm. When I think what I'm hearing you say is that like empty spaces, disused spaces, and even disused materials are as much a part of life before, well before the apocalypse, as they are life after the apocalypse.
Yeah.
I mean, we go around, we pass by these spaces all the time, like living in the city or living in whatever, like exurban areas or what have you, you know. Okay. So I wanted to know why sports then, right?
Yeah.
So is it the materials? Is it materials and spaces? Like that's kind of what that was like my guess.
Yeah, because I'd used collage again in the stuff in the show,
mm-hmm.
but it's used in like a very obvious way. It's not used as paint or like a mysterious material. You don't have to go in and try to see what's paint, what's collage, like how I enjoyed using collage in the past. It's kind of like scrapbooking. I did a like a talk for the opening because, you know, COVID. So
right.
I did a talk and I was talking about how it's scrapbooking, like kind of like this weirdness here that I was experimenting with is just like a more obvious version of the scrapbooking, where it's like the ugly wood paneling and like the weird collection that, you know, some guy who's obsessed with all these athletes is like collecting their memorabilia and being
right.
like, oh, he got an award and
right.
I found it online. You know, it's not even their award. So
we're both laughing. I mean, is that funny? I mean, is that part of it? It's like
it's
humor.
Kind of sick and disgusting. I think like it's very subtle and it's not necessarily funny, but looking at neglected or misused spaces or like material that's used in a very strange and somewhat assembled in a totally improper way has always been part of it. Like nonsensical.
Right.
And originally it started with work about the environment. Like when I first started painting, I was talking about how we treat our environment.
Right.
And it's kind of morphed into this other thing. And I'm still trying to find out where I want to go with it.
Sure.
There is an underlying message always that's like, look at this ridiculously pathetic thing that someone made, or
right.
look at this, how this space is unused or misused or, that's why it's, you know, not apocalyptic because no one's dead. It's just looking like that now.
Right. It's like it's apocalyptic would mean, or post-apocalyptic would mean that you're like imagining some distant future, but you're talking
yeah.
about this is the present. I mean, these are images of the present.
Yeah. And that wall could be anyone's wall. But how I got from there, I went from the historic spaces because I love history, and what I love about historic photographs is like you kind of get sucked in and you have to imagine what it was like because you'll never be able to live it.
Right.
So I was just layering photographs and creating new spaces because I was layering three or four historic glass plates that, and then kind of adding my spin to it. It's something, it feels like a place, but it's not a place. So playing around with deeper space got me more recently. I did all the collage stuff in the meantime, and then I found myself back in the sports theme in a way. I took a class at Lehman, and I was kind of making chaos pieces, and my professor said maybe play around with the sports a little, like embrace it a little bit more, because I had mentioned the public spaces so many times
mm-hmm.
in my older work.
Mm-hmm.
So I started making more limited space collages about painting, but about space
mm-hmm.
and limitations in space.
Mm-hmm.
So they are just very different. And I don't know if that's really where I'm going to continue to go, but I wanted to experiment with what I could do with an isosceles triangle. You know, how can I, in one of those pieces behind you, they're just pennant shapes. In the show, there's a lot of pennant shapes. They,
mm-hmm.
It's just a triangle, but it became the representation of something else. And I used the triangle over and over again, and it's red. I think it's red as a pennant. And I kind of riffed off of that, and I just started using more sports symbolism that's vague. And, you know, when taken out of context, is very painterly. But when you look at a track and you're running track, you're not looking at down at the lines.
Right.
You're not looking at the lines. And that came about by mistake, too, when I was just experimenting with fine taping with this model tape that you'd use in model making and pinstriping.
Uh-huh.
Just making these lines kind of, you know, go in a very strategic way and then unravel. And it turned into something that appeared to be a track. There's really, you know, no real reason why it looks like a track, but I added black and white Xerox copies of historic sports moments and kind of like abstracted them a little bit and just slapped them down on the surface. And then all of a sudden they read as sports pieces.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like that
right.
one, which is like obviously some guy's
right,
basement.
Right, right.
Where he, you know, drinks beer by himself and cries when his favorite team loses. So it's It's they're a little bit different, and I think I went extra with it here. And to me, I enjoy making this, and I enjoy looking at it. But I do like that space that's undefined, and this is completely defined. While the work in the show is only defined by the use of collage, almost like everything else is just shapes,
yeah,
mark making. And like abstract symbolism,
meaning that the process is evident, but there's no sense of space implied in the work. Is that what you're saying?
Well, it is limited space, mm-hmm. but everything that I'm using, like the mark making,
mm-hmm.
is all they're just shapes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in adding context through the photograph, it gives the whole thing a sports theme.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, I named the show Benched, but other than that, if I took away those collage elements, it would just be an abstract painting.
Right.
It might be a painting more about action and movement.
Right.
It might be a painting more about play and experimentation with the material. But you add that reference there and you start to direct the viewer on a different journey, like a more specific journey.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it is cheesy to talk about dream scenarios and stuff, but when you experience things, like when I went to a rooftop barbecue in Brooklyn for the first time, like 2008, it was like life changing.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, this is real. Like, mm-hmm. I could only imagine that this would happen.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know. There's something magical about making art. And
wait, but why?
I can't stop.
Why was that scenario like essentially dreamlike? Is what you're saying?
I mean,
what's the tie-in there?
I guess that dreamlike feeling that you see sometimes when you explore a space, like some of the gymnasiums,
yeah.
that are layered,
yeah.
layered and layered, yeah. layered. They're not real. They don't exist. They're kind of like fabricated from different things. So it feels real, but it's a new space and you can explore it.
Mm-hmm.
And there's I try to like not define too much, because you know, art has to be something that you look at and you get to travel, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how much of it is still that way, but you know, art that I'm drawn to, I have a role, right? Some abstract painting, you had a role, and sometimes they didn't direct you enough so you could go wherever you want. You could have a whole philosophical conversation about why there's a square, right?
Right.
And it's fun. But when someone gives you a little bit more information, but not enough, like there's still room to travel and have conversation. You're not, and I guess there always is in portraiture. You can paint somebody's face and you can still travel into like that whole spin-off of who is the person, why do they exist, what are they feeling.
Sure.
So I guess I'm just realizing now that I just keep pushing away from, like, I've always kept pushing away from representational imagery but embracing it at the same time, and it kind of makes no sense. But I like representational imagery, and I don't know. Doing more abstract and loose and experimental things with representational imagery is okay. I don't know.
Yeah.
Giving the viewer enough to travel with, but leaving a lot of information out. And I don't know. I tried to do that with the sports pieces, and I tried to do that with all the work, but I don't know where I was going with that.
Go. It's more, it's, you just said off camera, it's more, it's the visuals of sports that...
Yeah, so I know we kind of went and I started explaining all sorts of things, but, you know, aside from doing this,
right.
The work in the show, yeah, it was inspired by, like, looking at the courts, remembering these spaces, like a 1949 gymnasium in my hometown with a linoleum that was, chipping apart on the floor, and you used to have to turn the lights on, and it would take 15 minutes
right.
for the gym lights
totally.
To turn on. And there were all these bulbs up on the stage that overlooked the gym, and there were like 100 or 200 of these small bulbs that lit up the stage.
Totally.
And it was beautiful. It's beautiful to look at a maple court with right. blue lines on it.
Right.
It's attractive. And I just started digging from public space back into like what I see on a day-to-day, I suppose. The track at the school I work at, the gymnasium here in Beacon, there's pools, the old Pratt gym with the abandoned pool in it, with the rings that hang from the ceiling and all the equipment from like gymnastics from the early 1900s. The visuals to me and like the artifacts are interesting. And even though I have no inclination towards sports, the cycling's a different story. And there's some cycling pieces in the show yeah. that I wanted to donate to Recycle Bike.
Totally.
But the basketball that I grew up with my father and my brother gravitated toward, and I used to have to go to games, and then I had to quit sports, and my dad was a coach, and there's a lot of weight to it. So of course some of that comes into making pieces about sports, but it's really about my perspective of viewing sports, which is, you know, I really like watching sports, but here's something I do really appreciate. I appreciate these large, vast, like public spaces or private spaces that are designated for like to throw a ball into a hoop or like to kick a ball into a goal or bowling. Like we just had a bowling alley here in Beacon shut down like 6 years ago or so. And it's a whole building that is dome-like, looks almost ready for World War II to park planes in or something.
Right.
And you throw a heavy ball down a beautiful maple alley, and there's inlaid dots, and there's arrows for direction for some reason. Like, people have to know what way to throw the ball. and on tracks, I ran track, and I just, for some reason, because I guess I wasn't that involved in it mentally, and I didn't run all the different races. There's so many specific markings on a track that are for certain things. Measurements,
right.
starting points, certain games that you can play. Like, I really got fixated on, there's a company out there that paints multi-courts, so you could have volleyball, basketball, badminton, I don't know, all these court markings all together but in different colors on one court. And the way it looks is like a beautiful abstract painting. I don't know what half the sports are that those markings accommodate, but it's interesting because that information is there and it's there to decode. Like if you have that knowledge of that sport, you can see those lines no problem.
Right. Go. Now, as the video goes on, the takes begin with me saying go. That's a new motif.
So where I'm headed from this show is, you know, probably not exploring as much of the flat space. Mm-hmm. I just went really, there were more pieces. There's 20 pieces in the show, and mm-hmm. I had a lot more
mm-hmm.
sitting around. You know, dealing with flat space, and I'd like to take some of what I've experimented with back to exploring deep space again, not actual space, but
right.
the illusion of these deep spaces like courts and gymnasiums, and going into a little bit more history again. You know, taking references from things that have lost their meaning. You know, like an antique tool that I bring in for my students to do for drawings. I always pick things that I barely know the use of the tool. It doesn't have a function anymore, and no one uses that tool. It's outdated. It's something that's thrown to the side. So there's a lot of mystery to it, and it's intriguing, and you might never figure out what it's for unless you're digging through eBay instruction manuals for things.
Uh-huh.
And that curiosity is something that I hoped to be able to generate in other people. Like when you're a child and you're looking at the world and everything is just so interesting.